Hey everyone, what's up? So today's video is basically me answering the questions that you put in my DMs. So if you slid in my DMs, thank you. Hopefully this video is helpful. I think really it's centered towards what you guys are wondering about, whether it's about TRNA school or just like what life looks like now for any anesthesia student. So here are the DMs and we'll just go through them. So the first question is, thoughts on being a new grad in the ICU. Okay, so I started out in the ICU, and I can tell you that I thought starting out in the ICU as a new grad was probably harder than coming to anesthesia school. Personally, it wasn't that my nursing school didn't do a good job like preparing me to be a nurse, but the learning curve, especially in the ICU, is like really, really steep. There's just like a lot to learn, and you think it's easy just having like one or two patients, and it's just like nonstop. I think I just like kind of struggled with like time management. Also, I never worked night shift before, and then I got thrown into rotating shifts. So that made it hard. I moved away from my family. I didn't have any friends when I moved. I didn't have any family that was close. So I think that all made it difficult, and plus, it was just like taxing. My orientation was pretty long. It was a couple months. And by the end of that, like, I didn't exactly feel ready to take care of patients on my own, but I felt like I had a solid base. So if you're looking at like different ICUs, you should see if they have like a new grad program or like mentorship. We had that at Hopkins. It was great. I think it made a huge difference in me like progressing. But I just thought it was really tough. I spoke about the ICU book by Mariano. I'll link it in the description, but I think that book was like super helpful, especially because I will always say that I'm like definitely weaker when it comes to respiratory. So that was helpful. So hopefully that answered your question. Okay, the next one. This person had three questions. So first one is, should I take the GRE even though the schools I'm applying to only require organic chem and physics? I think it's school dependent. I don't think you should just take the GRE just to take it, because that seems like a huge pain in the butt. If you're looking at schools that want the GRE, then obviously yeah, and I would like study hard for it. But every school that I was even thinking about applying to either didn't want the GRE if your GPA was above the certain level or didn't require it. So I would really look into what schools you want to apply for before you pay the money to take that test and probably take a course to study for it. Also, what is your opinion on very small cohorts versus large cohorts? Dude, I would do small cohorts any day. I know there's a school out in Texas that like has huge cohorts, and I just don't even see how that's feasible in anesthesia school. You're paying all this money, and most cohorts are like 20-ish people. That's how big mine is, and you get a lot of individualized attention that way. I just can't really see like it being conducive to learning to have such a big class. I would go small cohort all the way. That's just my thought on it. Third question was, do the clinical skills like intubating nerve blocks become overwhelming / nerve wracking doing in clinical because they look hard to do? So I think all skills, like when you don't know how to do them, are look hard. But it's kind of just like muscle memory, like especially intubating. It's not that it's hard. It just takes practice. So I feel pretty comfortable like intubating anyone at this point. Like I have a blade of choice, and that's the MAC-4. I know some people don't like that blade, but I love it. I feel like pretty confident like intubating almost anyone with it. I will say I'm not very confident with the Miller, and that's probably because I haven't had pediatrics yet. But it's just muscle memory and practicing. Like, are you gonna miss your first intubation? You might, and like, that's fine. That's like your student. You're gonna learn. You're gonna mess up. You're gonna intubate the esophagus. You're not gonna get a view sometimes. Like, it is what it is. So I think all those skills come with time. The nerve blocks, those are a little bit different because you have to know, obviously you need to know your airway anatomy with intubating, but with the nerve blocks, nerve blocks are harder, for sure. I've only done a few, and there have been like adductor canals and stuff like that, ones that are a little bit more, I don't want to say easy, but like more easy than maybe doing like a brachial plexus or something like that. But I think, you know, everything comes with just muscle memory, so I think that after doing it for a while, it shouldn't be that bad. Okay, this one. Ways to become better prepared for CRNA school. I'm going to be assuming that you are accepted to CRNA school and want to be better prepared in the like interim time. So I would definitely recommend like brushing up on nervous system stuff like autonomic and somatic and just like sympathetic and all that good stuff. Just like knowing like the receptors, how your skeletal muscle contracts and like the neuromuscular junction and all that good stuff. And just like knowing some basic pharmacology. Like I wouldn't go and learn like anesthesia pharmacology. I think that's like why you're paying money in school to learn it. But like some of your drugs that you'd use all the time as an ICU nurse or, you know, when you start anesthesia, like phenylephrine, ephedrine, propofol, succinylcholine, rocuronium, that stuff, I would probably know how it works. But like, I honestly, the 2 months leading up to CRNA school, like, I chilled. I went on vacation. I kind of relaxed because once like school starts, you don't get that time at all. It's like you hit the ground running. So just like if you got accepted and you only have like 2 months to go, chill. Just chill. Okay, this person said, I applied last year to CRNA school and didn't get accepted. I'm doing my CMC, joining committees, and shadowing more CRNAs. What else can I do to stand out? And do you recommend taking any graduate level courses? I'm super sorry that you didn't get in. Please don't give up. What else do I recommend for you to stand out? Okay, there's a couple things. So, one, yes, taking a graduate level course I think is a great idea, especially like pathophys, because you'll probably be taking that somewhere in your first year. I think that shows you're really committed. Joining committees. So, this is the thing that I would caution. I would do one thing and do it really well. Don't pick a bunch of things and then like kind of half-ass all of them because it just like, just do one thing and do it well. So, if that's like teaching or precepting or whatever, just like pick that and focus on it. Something that I did, but I was already like accepted to school, but I think it actually is a huge benefit if you're looking to get into school is go to some of the diversity CRNA things by Dr. Gold. She's awesome. The programs that she puts on are so good. And there's like a ton of ways that you can like network and connect with other CRNAs and CRNA students. So I met Nurse Nell there. I met the director of the Columbia University nurse anesthesia program there, and I actually met someone from the cohort above me that was like starting school in a week. So I would do those things. Like shadowing is great, but like how much shadowing can you do? Because you can't really do anything when you're shadowing. I wouldn't go like crazy with the shadowing. But it sounds like you're doing all the right things. But definitely, yeah, take a graduate level course and you know see how you do, even if you just are getting your feet wet. This one says, how has COVID-19 affected your clinicals? That's a great question. So I'm not in clinical right now anymore and have like I'm kind of bummed. So having clinical off for a week is really nice because you don't have to wake up at like 4 a.m. in the morning. But I really miss it. I'm not gonna lie, I like really miss working with my preceptors there and just like doing anesthesia. So in lieu of clinical, what we're doing now is like virtual clinical where we get case studies in the morning and we work in teams of three. And then there's like two moderators, which are two third year students. And we break up, we do like an anesthetic plan, kind of like a care plan. And then we'll look up stuff about like the pathophys and whatnot. I actually really like these because they're cases that like I haven't done yet, like liver transplants and stuff like that. So that's how we're keeping our like, you know, clinical mentation skills up. Obviously there's really not a good way to practice like intubating or like doing IVs and stuff like that, but I'm not like super concerned about that stuff just because it all is like muscle memory. I don't know when we're going to be going back. I'm obviously bummed. I was supposed to be starting call, but, you know, not doing elective cases right now is just the, what's best for everyone. So stay tuned. All right. The next question is, is it easy to maintain relationships in CRNA school? I don't know. So I won't speak from my personal experience, but I think that the key is having like a partner that understands that you're super busy and is supportive of that. So, I mean, there's people in my class that are married and have kids, and obviously they've figured out a way to make it work. But I think you just need to be with someone that understands that this is basically like a huge, huge chunk of your life. So that's all I have to say about that. Okay. The next one is, how are you paying for CRNA school? I feel like I could see my mom like shaking her head. It depends. So some of my classmates have saved up a bunch of money and they're able to use their like saved funds. Some have taken out private loans, and you can take out private loans from like Discover, stuff like that. And then a lot of other people, what they do and what I do is I do Grad Plus. So it's a federal government student loan that basically will cover your tuition, and then the school allots what you should be like getting for like rent and like food and stuff like that. So you can basically like cover all your living expenses and tuition with that. The issue with Grad Plus is that the like interest rate on it right now, I think, is like 7%. So it's not like great. It's actually like, it's actually pretty bad. But there's a ton of different like loan companies out there. The one thing I did to like be proactive in it was to, one, make a budget, because I was never on a budget when I was a nurse. Because if there was something that I wanted to do, I just worked overtime, and I worked like a ton of overtime. And then I like contacted my school's financial aid department before I even started school, just to like have an idea of how I would pay for this and what everything kind of looks like. And I think that really helped. So make a budget and kind of try to stick with it, because otherwise you're just gonna be like in a ton of debt when you graduate. And, like, we're all going to be in a ton of debt, so try to minimize it if you can. Okay. The next question is, how is it, like, working with anesthesiologists? Do you feel like there's a lot of competition between nurse and anesthetist students and anesthesia residents? I actually really like working with the anesthesiologist, at least at my site. They are great teachers. Unless you're doing blocks, you don't really see them a ton and like just really on induction, and that's kind of it. But I think I've learned a lot from them, like masking techniques and all that good type of stuff. Even doing like awake arterial lines has been super helpful. So I don't really have anything negative to say, about that. As far as anesthesia residents, so the site I'm at is kind of special in that it only uses surgery residents. So there's no competition for cases. So whatever case there is, like, it's going to an anesthesia student, a nurse anesthesia student. I can say that some of my classmates are at other sites that heavily rely on their anesthesia residents. And obviously, like, I don't feel like they ever get like booted off of things, but I know there's like certain cases that they don't let nurse anesthesia students do at certain sites. I haven't experienced that, so I'm not really privy to say. I've never had an issue with it. I feel like we can all kind of work together. So I don't really know. I don't really have a problem with it. I actually really like working with anesthesiologists. I know some people have differing thoughts on that, but Pennsylvania is not a state where CRNAs can practice independently. So that's just kind of my experience. I'm sure if you went to California or Florida, it would be a lot different. But that's just what I know. So there you have it. I actually think that was the last question. So hopefully you guys liked this. And let me know what you want to see next. Bye, guys.